November 19, 1941. German troops commanded by General Kleist arrive in the city of Rostov, opening the door for Germany from the Volga Basin and the oil sources of the Caucasus. This advance was made, despite the fact that the first frosts were already occurring throughout the Eastern Front. From the German High Command, they held their breath, because without a doubt they knew that with these latest offensives they were risking everything. Although they had long abandoned the main objective of Operation Barbarossa, which had to lead them to the famous Archangel Astrakhan line, the taking of Leningrad, as well as Moscow and Rostov, was still in their plans. At this point, in which the last offensives were being launched throughout the front, we have to say that despite many indications arriving, in which it was indicated that things were not going well, the expectations of the German high command continued through the roof and his confidence in victory was total. The general idea was that despite the many casualties we have suffered in this campaign, the Soviets have suffered far more, and must be on the brink of total collapse. The reality, as we know today, was very different, since the Red Army, far from being in the last, as everything seemed to point, was in full capacity, preparing counter-offensive throughout the front. And it was precisely in the Rostov sector where the first one occurred. It all started in mid-November 1941, when the 1st Panzer Army began to make its way in the direction of Rostov, just above the Sea of Azov. This unit quickly took control of the city, and continued to enter Soviet territory to the east, taking some bridgeheads over the Don River. If we look closely at the map, we can see that this penetration generated a significant overhang on the Soviet line, giving Timoshenko a perfect opportunity to counterattack. To this weakness that the German troops that were within this salient already had, we have to add that the northern flank was protected by Hungarian troops, which had worse equipment than the Germans had, which already had it was precarious. As if that were not enough, parts of the Don River were already frozen, which made it easier for the Red Army to cross it and attack. With a situation like this, the totally unexpected Soviet offensive for the Germans began on November 27, and within hours, the German troops had to retreat and abandon their position in Rostov. This withdrawal of about 100 kilometers had to be made to the River Meuse, where they could once again establish defensive positions. This withdrawal was completed by the beginning of December, and it was the first major withdrawal of the Wehrmacht on Soviet territory. However, and as we will see later, it would be a few days later in the surroundings of Moscow, when the most powerful Soviet offensives would take place. But before we get to that, let's see how this first withdrawal came about. As we have previously pointed out, both Hitler and part of the High Command were euphoric at these latest offensives and were confident that all the objectives would finally be achieved. When the first reports began to arrive on days 27 and 28 that part of the German southern wing was being forced to retreat, they went into a rage. His first reaction was to prohibit any withdrawal order and to go so far as to blame the generals in the area for lack of capacity. They refused to believe that the units of Field Marshal Rundstedt, who commanded the armies of the southern sector, were not strong enough to contain the Soviet offensive and continue to advance. And like his subordinate Kleist, they were crossed out. Incompetent. In a similar way to what Manstein would do a few months later, on November 30th, Rundstedt sent a telegram to the High Command in which he told them that if they no longer had confidence in him, he wanted to be relieved of the command of the armies assigned to him. The next morning, Hitler, neither short nor lazy, dismissed Rundstedt and put Reichenau in his place. The order he received was to stop the retreat of the German troops in the sector at all costs. However, just a few hours after taking control of these units, Reichenau informed the German leader that the withdrawal further back from the Meuse River had become inevitable. Let us remember that, at this moment, the German offensives on Moscow were continuing and that the Soviet counterattacks had not yet taken place in the area, although it was not long. On December 3rd, Hitler himself traveled by plane to Ukraine to be informed in person of what was happening. "First I speak to the commander of the 1st Waffen-SS Division Leibstandarte, this being Sepp Dietrich. This told him that indeed, there was no choice but to withdraw, supporting the same decision as the quarterback who had just been dismissed. Coincidentally, Rundstedt, who was still there, was also called into the Führer's presence, and the Führer apologized to him, although he did not return command. He was sent back to Germany, alluding to health problems, and as a gesture of goodwill, a few days later he was given a check for 250,000 marks for his birthday. This was the moment in which Paulus made an appearance at the request of Reichenau himself, who told Hitler that he could not take over the command of Army Group South and the 6th Army at the same time. He advised the German leader to put Paulus in charge of the 6th Army, and finally Hitler accepted. This conversation took place that same day, December 3rd, when Hitler was making said visit. Just 2 days later, the Soviets launched their counter-offensive in the Moscow sector, and now it was not only the southern front that was under attack, but the entire German line from the Sea of Azov to Leningrad. In case things couldn't get worse, on January 12, 1942, a few days after Paulus's appointment, Field Marshal Reichenau suffered a heart attack while playing sports. This left Paulus momentarily as the head of the area, being a military man who had no experience as a direct commander of units. This situation also coincided with new offensives that the Red Army was launching in the area, between Kharkov and Kursk, which again drove the Germans back. Eventually, Field Marshal von Buck was sent to the area to take command of Army Group South, while Paulus maintained command of the 6th Army. The Soviet attacks on those dates established the front line next to Kharkov, this being the sector through which the Red Army would again launch another offensive on May 12, giving rise to the Second Battle of Kharkov, which we already saw here. In any case, the situation in which the German army divisions were left after all these combats was dramatic. By March 1942 of the 162 infantry divisions that the Wehrmacht had in total on this scene, only 8 of them were ready to go into combat immediately. 47 had a limited capacity, not being far from 100% of their troops, but still they could participate in some minor action. Another 73 divisions were badly beaten after the fighting and could only offer service in limited defensive engagements. And finally, the other 34 remaining were even more depleted and could barely offer a minimum defensive capacity if their sector was attacked. With regard to the 16 Panzer divisions, it should be noted that their situation was not much better, since they barely added about 140 operational combat tanks between all of them. This means that among these 16 armored divisions, they did not even have the number of total panzers that only one of them should have in full. Well then, having seen how the first important setback of the German army in the Soviet Union was, which was only the first warning of what would come a few days later, and how was this rise of Paulus also, I invite you to see a special program we did about Paulus in which we saw the reasons why he did not get to withdraw from Stalingrad, and I also leave you the one about the Second Battle of Kharkov. Finally, I encourage you to join our Patreon community, where you can enjoy different benefits. I will leave you all the links in the description. This is all. Subscribe and support the channel if you like this program, and see you in the next one. See you soon.